of ICS EH Club in collaboration with Nvest Labs. I would like to take this opportunity to extend a warm welcome to our speakers for the day, Mr. Sharupan Prakashpati, CEO of Nvest Group of Companies and the Global Exchange Company. At the age of 23 years, Mr. Sharupan became a great inspiration to many youngsters across the globe.
I think I'm for my age,
I
man.
Would request a HOD to please felicitate Mr. Sharupan with a sapling and memento.
Oh, okay. Nice. A leaf. That's very nice. Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
And our third speaker for the day is Mr. Ramesh G. He's the blockchain instructor for Nvest Labs. He's an Ethereum blockchain trainer. He has a total of 9 years experience in different industries. He's going to help
us set this up. Why are you asking me? Ask your boy.
So on the behalf of our department, we would like to also welcome all the other guests who are there for the event.
Yeah, Mr. Angel, he has also
Ariel, like the mermaid. Like the mermaid.
So I would like to thank our chairman, Dr. Mohan Magnani, in his absentia, our principal, Dr. Manjunatha, in his absentia, and our HOD for providing us with this opportunity to conduct such an interesting event. Thank you, ma'am. Looking forward to a great session. Thank you.
Great. Okay. So, housekeeping rules. Mostly when people do housekeeping rules, they tell you guys things not to do or things to do. Actually, all my housekeeping rules are about myself. I have a tendency to talk very fast. I apologize in advance. As you may have picked up, my accent is a little funny. I apologize in advance. Unfortunately, I cannot speak any of the local, like, linguistic languages. I would love to, so I apologize in advance. And I use a lot of, like, cryptocurrency and, like, computer science slang, so I apologize in advance. Now, with all of that in mind, if you guys do need me to repeat something or if you want me to expound on a specific topic, just let me know. You feel free to interrupt me whenever you want. I think this is going to be a very inquisitive type of conversation, and I hope that by the end of today, you guys are slightly more interested in understanding the profound impacts of the blockchain. So are all of you guys in one, like, kind of group, like one semester, one class? Eighth semester, which is the final semester, which means you guys are almost out of here. I remember my final semester at school. It was my first one. that's amazing. So you guys have now been here for almost 4 years, if I'm not mistaken. 4 years. All information science students, so about to be information science graduates. How many people are from, like, Bangalore, like, natively they're from here? Almost half. Everyone else is from somewhere else. Very cool. So you guys have now all spent the better half of your undergraduate degree at New Horizon. Very interesting. So I guess the next set of questions I always like to ask is, how many people here have heard the word blockchain? Anywhere, like internet, newspaper, social media, just heard the word before I just said it today. Okay, that's a reasonable amount. How many people have heard the word cryptocurrency? Almost the same amount, maybe a little bit more. How many people have ever used a cryptocurrency? Thank you. I would suspect so, that someone from here has used it. How many people in here are proficient at JavaScript? How many people in here know what JavaScript is? There we go. At least the second one. Yeah, you should know, right? That's fine. No, I mean, proficient is a scary word, so I apologize for using that word. But know JavaScript to some degree. Okay. And how many people in here are interested in working in some new format of the technology sector? Could be IoT, could be machine learning, artificial intelligence, obviously blockchain. How many of you have aspirations to work in one of those kind of subsectors? Nobody. So everyone's programming C++, I see. No, I'm joking. okay, no, that's cool. I just like to get a gauge. I don't talk too much about the company because I find it to be a slightly boring subject without the websites up, but I'll give you a 2-second background on myself, how I got here, what we're trying to do, and then I will spend the majority of my time with you talking about the computer science conditions that has led to the inception and the proliferation of blockchain. Please don't believe anything that I'm going to say. Assume everything I'm going to say is a complete lie, because the only way to truly understand about the blockchain is by going and finding out yourself. So the only thing I hope to do is inspire some controversy, and on the back of that, you will do your research if it intrigues you. If it doesn't intrigue you, then I'm just very boring, I guess. So background on myself, and they'll show some videos after about kind of the institution that we built. I was born in a place called Toronto, Canada, not like Canada the language, but the cold country on the other side of the world. And so was Ariel. Me and Ariel were both born there. It's shocking that we both arrived here somehow. And I have had a pretty illustrious time pre what I'm doing now in the foreign exchange markets. So foreign exchange is like foreign currencies and how they interact with each other. I went to school for mechanical engineering, but lost interest quite rapidly in that subject. I wish I had gone to school for computer science. I probably would have been much more aptitude at that subject. In 2017, me and my co-founder, his name is Warren Carson, a much older gentleman than I am. He's actually coming to India tonight, which is really like astonishing that both of us are gonna be here. We started a company called Nvest Bank. Oh, here we go. Yes, Nvest Bank. And Nvest Bank was an crazy, I would imagine, idea in 2017 that we believe that we can build a similar banking institution based on digital ledger technology for cryptocurrencies. And our unique proposition was that we were going to build branches all over the world and have like a SBI version for crypto. That was a very controversial idea, because cryptocurrencies globally was a very controversial idea, and we were quite successful in doing that. Our first branch was in Toronto, Canada. I'll show you a video about it. Our second branch was also in Toronto, and then we proliferated out to the United Kingdom. In 2018, things got really interesting, because the cryptocurrency markets, which had boomed in 2017, by boomed I mean they went from a very cheap price to a very expensive price. To be specific, in January of 2017, I bought my first Bitcoin. It was valued at about $960 US. By the end of that year, it was valued at $21,000. So it had increased by 21 times. When something increases by 21 times in 1 year, that makes everybody pay attention. That means governments, large companies, universities, non-for-profits, now all wanted to learn about cryptocurrencies. They didn't understand it, they still don't understand it, but they were interested. In 2018, guess what happened? You know, there's an old saying in finance that nothing grows to the sky. Trees don't grow to the sky. And the point of that story is that everything that goes up, how they always come down. And anything that appreciates that quickly starts to collapse as quickly. So the price of Bitcoin starts to tumble. And that gave us at Nvest a very great opportunity, because what we did during that time is we started to expand our incubation services. And that's a fancy word for saying we like to take companies that are like just ideas and turn them into functioning enterprises. How do we do that? We provide them with the core technology competency to do so. What's our core technology competency? We're only good at one thing, blockchain. We're actually horrible at everything else. And so with that basis in mind, we launched the Nvest Group. That, now you can go back to the first part. Middle one. Yeah. So the Nvest Group, or go to invest.co, however you were there before. Like, this is invest.com, but invest.co. Just go up and click M, like take out M. Oh, no, there it goes. Oh, sorry, the internet's just thin. Yeah, this is, if you scroll down, keep scrolling down, keep going, yeah, scroll down. So these are the companies that we have since invested or acquired in, and they range from everything you can imagine. They are data transmission to obviously banking to exchange technology to even some things within the IoT space, but all kind of based in this rudimentary belief that distributed ledger technology is going to underpin the way that computer science and finance evolves. And so in 2018, we started expanding those services. And we were actually at the time really based in the United Kingdom. And as I was telling the HOD, one of my friends who was running my UK office told me, you should come to Bangalore. And I had never been. And so I was in. I was speaking at a conference in Singapore. And in August of 2018, I take a flight from Singapore to Bangalore. And I land here for the first time, and I'm like, man, there's a lot of people. man, this is as a first thing I got, I'm like, so many people. But I was so excited. I had got an office because my board had said Sharpan, because they know my tendency. They said Sharpan, only hire 5 people because that's all we need to support our operations, and leave. So I get there. And I get like a small office. I think the office was like this big. It was in JP Nagar. And we started hiring some people. Actually, the first 2 people we hired were interns from, was it BIT? Kirtan Espirite? Yeah, BIT. And obviously, they didn't know anything about blockchain because that's like a rare skill. And but they were very ambitious aspiring graduates. And so we hired 2 of them. And then I just saw the biggest opportunity of our lifetime, which is, what if you can take competent graduates that know web-based programming languages, whether it could be even something that's deployed directly on the web, like a JavaScript, or even something that can correspond well with WebSockets, however you want to look at it, kind of this new age type of programming infrastructure, and you can specialize them in blockchain technology, that the demand for blockchain engineers at that time had increased 3x in the last month. If the LinkedIn posts for blockchain engineers had increased 3 times in 1 month when I was in India for the first time. That's what I remember vividly. And I'm like, whoa, what if we can build kind of like this like campus, not like an institute, like an education campus, but like this facility where we can bring in the best blockchain developers or bring in non-blockchain developers and turn them into blockchain developers because we have all the companies that want to solicit their services. So I called my board and I said, I'm not coming home. and they said, oh God. And Warren's like, my goodness, what have we done? They figured that at the end of my visa I would leave, but they obviously didn't know how the time was. Over the next 5 months, between August of last year and January, I think I hired like 70 more interns or some crazy amount of interns like that. And we trained them literally in the field on blockchain. Like they started their first day of internship and they might have known JavaScript. Some of them knew a little bit of JavaScript. And we said, all right, here's your blockchain project, go figure it out. And so they had to learn quite hands-on, I would imagine. At the end of December, which was only about 4 months with me, they had all picked up the skills. They're not experts, but they had pretty much picked up the skills as they had to pick up the skills to work in what they're doing. And that's when I realized, whoa, like what if we can streamline this? What if we can take this and turn this into like a mechanism where any developer can come, become a blockchain developer, and then really work for any company around the world because it's such a global demand. And so that's when we launched Nvest Campus. If you want to go to YouTube and go to like the Nvest Campus YouTube channel, you can do that. They have all these like Nvest Campus videos in like the Google Drive. I need to like figure out where they are. YouTube. Or type in Nvest Labs or Nvest Campus, one of them will work. One word, please. Yeah, that's fine. And click it. Yeah, you can actually do the evolution of Nvest Campus. That's a cool video. This one. Second. Yeah. So this was our facility in now it's JNugger. like another floor added to that now, and like it's pretty intense. But that kind of gives you an understanding of what the operations look like here. And really simply put, all of those people are working on a project mostly involving cryptocurrencies, but some of them are not involving cryptocurrencies and just focus more on the blockchain. So why are we here today? Why did your faculty force you to come listen to me? Why are we consuming all of this energy? Is because we have a requirement for blockchain developers. That requirement is in the thousands. There's no way that we can fill that requirement at all. That is a requirement comprised of the biggest companies in the world, whether like across the street, that's a Wells Fargo, or that's Bank of America, or that's Nvest, or that's Government of India. There is tremendous people needed for blockchain. The issue is nobody knows how to program in the blockchain. And so to cover that gap, we have launched a certification unit called Nvest Labs, which Ruffy would go on if he was sitting there, but he'll show you when you get back. You can check it out at investlabs.com. And Nvest Labs is essentially another floor that we added to that campus that is fully focused on certifying blockchain developers, training them, taking them really from kind of prenatal JavaScript all the way to being proficient in what we would look at like Solidity and different structures within Ethereum development. And that's really what Ramesh teaches, as well as a variety of other blockchain programs. And we are here to make you aware, not about us, because frankly, that doesn't matter about us, but that if you graduate, and I think, how many months do you have left before graduation? Okay, 4 months, 4 short months. Let me tell you, the world on the other side of graduation sucks, right? This whole allure that, you want to hurry up and graduate so that you can, move on. That's not true. This is the best time of your life, right? I recall back to the thing. This is the greatest time you're ever going to have. You can make experiments. You can have ideas. You can have conversations about topics. You can learn new things. You have electives. You can stay home. You can come to school. I mean, these are just great luxuries that in 4 months you will not have anymore. But one thing I can tell you about is that if you leave this institution without some knowledge about blockchain, you don't need to be an expert. You might not ever want to work in it, but without some knowledge, you are leaving technically illiterate. It would be like leaving not knowing iOS development in 2007. Right, in 2007, there were not many iOS engineers because the iPhone had just released. So it's not that everyone that was graduating in 2007 was going to be an app developer because it was just a new technology. But as an engineer, you have a duty to the craft of computer science to be aware of the shifts that's happening in your industry. So leaving with zero knowledge will make you highly, highly uncompetitive. Very similar to, like, I know you guys, faculty, this sector has a lot of focus on machine learning. It's like someone graduating in 2019, 2020, and not knowing anything about machine learning. You are leaving illiterate. So you have 4 months to really become literate. The job prospects on the other side of learning blockchain, excuse me for my French or my lack of things, are insane. The opportunities in today's world, in any country, but especially here, for blockchain engineers are mind-boggling. I have to overpay every single blockchain engineer by a multitude, like numerals I don't want to talk about because it saddens me. Because, number one, very rare. Number two, highly, like all companies are kind of like fighting over them, which just sucks because then you have to fight with like American Express and that's not going to go too well. And the number three thing is, it is not just a private sector technology. It's going to be used by every level of government. Now, if you think that just because the government doesn't like cryptocurrencies that they're not going to like blockchain, then you have not understood the blockchain. Every level of every government is currently investing into developing blockchain-based systems, even if they're against cryptocurrencies per se. And if they're like cryptocurrencies, then it's just insane how much they're jumping into it. Meaning, both the private sector and the public sector are craving, drooling for competent blockchain engineers, and there's a high discrepancy between them. So what is this blockchain thing? That's the real question. What are we talking about? Does anyone have even the faintest idea of how to define a blockchain? Don't worry, there's no wrong answers. Anything, one word, two words, rumors.
It's like a network based, it's a network where you store data in different blocks that are linked together with cryptographic hashes.
Wow. That's good. I'll repeat his answer. He said it's a network-based protocol, did you say?
Yeah.
It's a network-based protocol where you store data in different blocks that are linked together with cryptographic hashes. That sounds like a Wikipedia read-off, does it not? No, that's actually a good, succinct way of summarizing it. And I would imagine that if you were to go and watch a YouTube video about blockchain, that's what they would tell you. That's good that you know that, but that doesn't actually even begin to uncover the profound nature of this technology. Ramesh is going to assign some blockchain tasks, so I'm not going to take up the time talking about kind of the ground level. What I'm going to talk about is, why is there a blockchain? See, if I asked you, why is there artificial intelligence, what would you say? This is the artificial intelligence part, right? You guys are very good at this. Why is there artificial intelligence? Not what is. Anyone can say, what is artificial intelligence? That's very easy. Why is there artificial intelligence? Sorry, say that again.
To make people's life easier.
So he's saying to make people's lives easier. That's a really like good version of it. That's like a very friendly version of it. That's true. It does. It makes people's lives easier. Why are we facing artificial intelligence in 2020? What are the conditions that make it possible or make it necessary? As you said, the desire to make people's lives easier, the desire to process data faster, all of these things are there. From a technical perspective, why is there artificial intelligence? He says it's working 24 hours?
To reduce the workload.
To reduce the workload of what?
Of the employees.
Okay, to reduce the workload of employees, okay? Don't worry, there's no bad answers, just good ones. So technically speaking, the reason that there is artificial intelligence as a pending shift in 2020 is because the cost and the power of semiconductors have become so powerful as well as cheap that you can do very advanced computation for almost no money. In other words, the chips in your phones today are more powerful than what NASA had to use to put someone on the moon. Let me repeat that. The chips in your phone today that you use to send pictures of your food are more powerful than the processors that NASA used to put a man on the moon. The amount of data that's rendered in a very simple telecommunications line, 2G, forget about 5G, 2G, is more than all of the telegraphs that were passed between the United States and the United Kingdom during World War II. The processing power of semiconductors, the degree to which they've shrunk as a function of Moore's law, and the speed and bandwidth of the data transfers have made artificial intelligence an inevitability. People like Professor Hinton, I was taught at the University of Toronto by a guy named Professor Hinton. There's the incredible artificial intelligence minds in the early 70s, in the late 60s. But none of that could have came to fruition without the price of these fundamental infrastructures dropping and them going everywhere and the amount of raw data being transmitted. Because artificial intelligence, if I was to generalize, and I really don't like generalizing it because it is such a big topic, is nothing but the ability to wrangle data in an organized fashion. And you will write unlimited amounts of algorithms to wrangle that data, but in order to have any use for it, you need to be able to collect that data, store it, wrangle, and shoot it back into your phone or whatever it so may be. Similarly, when I say, why is there a blockchain? I'm saying, what are the conditions from a technical perspective that made a blockchain a feasible idea? And number two, sorry, go ahead.
Security.
This is the typical word people associate with blockchains. I would hope that we stop using the word security and we use the word immutability. Immutability almost means security, almost. But there's a little bit of a difference. Secure means, hey, you have something, maybe you have this mouse, maybe you have a piece of data, I will help you protect it. Okay? That means the system of security is built to protect or to enhance the walls that protect whatever he wants. If he wants to protect a set of data, if he wants to protect a human, that's you can build security systems for, right? And we would say that a good security system prevents people from getting in, and a bad security system lets people come in. Immutability is a little bit different. Immutability also means the same thing. You cannot tamper with it. But one small difference, even the creator cannot tamper with it. And that's very different than security. Because security means I create something, it's mine. And I'm going to make sure none of you guys can ever mess around with it. But if I want to mess around with it, that's fine. That is fundamental cybersecurity. Immutability is saying, I'm going to create something. I'm going to write a piece of code. And I'm going to put it out there. Or I'm going to make a song. It doesn't really matter what it is. I'm going to put it out there. And nobody can tamper with it, including me. And the frameworks, the protocols I put into place to make it immutable will ensure that if anyone tries to tamper with it, everyone will be notified. That sounds pretty great. Sounds like you and your, like you leaving five rupees under your mattress, I mean, you don't have 5 rupees, you're leaving 20 rupees under your mattress, and you telling your siblings don't touch it, and when you come home that day, it's gone. Now you have an investigation. If you had an immutable system, everybody would know even when you went to take it. This is the issue, though. Who does immutability not benefit? Facebook runs many, many millions of servers to keep up with all of the stuff you're doing, right? So every time you like something, you post something, you upload something, it's going into their server, it's saving. I don't know when you guys joined Facebook, but when I joined Facebook, I was in like grade 7. And it scares me that they have some of that information. I don't care about the stuff I did in the last 2 years because that's quite positive. But some of the things I was doing back then is very embarrassing. And so, as you know, nothing gets deleted. There's no such thing as deleting anything, particularly from the internet. Because the people that have secure, Facebook is very secure. As much as, you know, recently they've been enthralled in all of these hacks, Facebook is immensely secure. Trust me, to protect that much data and to have only one memorable hack is just astonishing. So Facebook is incredibly secure. They're not immutable. They tamper with data at scale, whether that's to sell you stuff via advertisements, whether that's to, you know, give your information to law officials. I mean, it doesn't really matter. That's not the point. I'm not making a call on that. I'm saying they have the ability to. Because as soon as you give your picture to Facebook, it goes into Facebook server somewhere in San Francisco, and whatever they want to do with it, they can do with it. Every time you go on that link, it'll show you that picture, but God knows what else has also been done to that picture. Now, Facebook loves security. They will not like immutability. Because immutability means every time they tamper with something, that's also kind of public. And that might not be great for a company that's built off of, you know, advertising as a revenue model. I'm not saying Facebook is good or bad. I'm saying that's the way that it's structured, right? And in the case of Facebook or social network, maybe immutability is not that important. Because maybe, you know, you're only dealing with simple, like I said, pictures. Maybe it's embarrassing, but it's not going to kill you if some picture from grade 7 emerges. But it's not going to be life or death. But there are systems that immutability is paramount, where if you don't have it to be immutable, you are talking about life or death. And as we know, everything today is regulated by some form of computer system. Can you think of an example where you would want that system so that nobody, including the creator, should not be able to tamper with it? Any examples? Banking would be the obvious one. that's the one that screams from the top of the mountains. Why? Because like you didn't like your brother taking your 20 rupees, I'm pretty sure you wouldn't like other strangers touching your money. And there's so much to talk about when it comes to banking and the concept of how information systems have already transformed banking and how they're going to do it again with the invention, with the proliferation of this technology. But I wish I could talk, but that would take days. I'll give you the Reader's Digest version. Money, currency, let's call it to be more specific, is a consensus construct. Even above the lines of a computer system. Meaning, if he believes it's money, and I believe it's money, we can do business, we can transact. However, if he believes it's money, and I don't believe it's money, unfortunately, we're not transacting. So, that's a consensus system. Meaning that it only works if two different nodes can achieve consensus. Okay. That concept is extrapolated at scale when it comes to a government-backed currency like an Indian rupee, because you have now 1.2 billion people that have to believe that this is money. And if you're talking about the US dollar, then there's 320 million people that have to all believe that this is money. Because if a couple of them don't believe this is money, this is not going to work so well. Does it make sense? Now take that into the world of digital banking, not blockchain. I'm now talking about like UPI or like Google Pay or PayPal or Apple Pay. That's called digital banking. That means you are no longer custodians of your money. You are observers of money transfers. See, when I take out my phone and I Google Pay you 50 rupees, all I witnessed was a money transfer. When I PayPal you some money, I witnessed a money transfer. And then you're going to take Google Pay and you're going to buy some pizza. See, I did some work for Sharath. He gives me Google, like he sends me some rupees, Google Pay, or PayPal. If I'm talking to Ariel, he'll send me some dollars. Then I have that in my account. So now I need to eat something. So I'm going to go to the store. I'm going to try to buy some food. And they're going to be like, do you have Google Pay? I'm like, yeah, I got Google Pay. I just got paid in Google Pay. Perfect. Let me send you some money. So then I send him some money and he gives me a pizza. See what just happened? I did work. I got compensated, I exchanged my compensation for food. Now, what I did know happened is kinetic energy was transmitted to do the work, whatever work I did for him. And I really got a pizza. Like I put that pizza in my belly. But do you know that any money was actually transacted? How do you prove that? Digital is fine, I mean, but how do you prove that money was transacted? Digital is, lots of things are digital. You can't, that's not bad. Or good, that's just something to think about. That the underpinnings of currency are highly centralized. Highly, highly, highly centralized. Like more centralized than Facebook. And people have lots of problems with Facebook. This is way, way crazier than Facebook. This is the control of all transaction ledgers in a country or any given country. Works the same way all around the world. Now, you're working hard, you're gonna finish, graduate here, you're gonna go get a job, you're gonna work every day, right? Every day you're gonna work, save up money, hopefully buy something, buy a house, take care of your family. To know that that is immutable would be such a powerful concept. And in 2008, a random person, who we have no idea who they are, said, you know what, that is a cool concept. Let me try it out. That person's name was Satoshi Nakamoto. That is not his real name. He's not Japanese. Trust me. We don't know who he is. We don't know if it was a boy or a girl. We don't know if he was tall or short. We don't know if he was black or white. We don't know if he was fat or skinny. We don't know if he was a human. He could have been five humans. He could have been an algorithm. We don't know if he was a Martian. We don't know anything. What we do know is that he published some open source code. You know open source code?
Yes.
He published some open source code. And it's like pressing a bomb, right? You think it's gonna explode, right? Like imagine you work on a bomb for a long time, or even like a little science project, and you're gonna show it to your school, and you're like, look at this bomb I just built, it's gonna be the coolest thing, and you press it, and nothing happens. and you're like, oh shit, this is not good. Excuse my language. That's what happened. He released the code, and guess what? Nobody cared. Nobody. And I don't think he expected people to care. I don't know if it's a he, but I'm just going to use the word he. I think he just thought this is a cool concept in cryptographic hash functions. We could talk about the technical. I mean, I'll explain how the genius behind what he did is unbelievable. Like, in my opinion, this is the modern day Charles Darwin. Like, this is the modern day, like, Sir Isaac Newton. This is the guy. We don't know if he's a guy. That's the only issue. But this is the guy, because that paper, you should read it, 11 pages of cryptographic brilliance. It's every time I read it, I get goosebumps. I've probably read it like 150 times at this point. I still cannot believe this occurred. But you know what? Nobody believed that it would do anything, even him. Because who is this guy? No one knows who he is. He's not a president or a prime minister. He's not a central bank. He's not Mark Zuckerberg. He's nobody. And in 2008, he just said, click, went into open source some chat forum on the internet, and nobody cared. Nobody blinked. The world went on. But then something happened. In 2008, there was the worst economic crisis to plague the Western world since the Great Depression. Here in the East, you guys experienced a smaller version of it, but it was still quite devastating. And the entire thesis of the Great Recession in 2008 was, does anybody know? How institutions that you are supposed to trust made very, very, very bad decisions that nobody was held accountable for. Nobody. Not one person. We don't know one person that went to jail because of that. We don't know one person that was held accountable. But we saw the equivalent of $9 trillion disappear very quickly. And so the world was torn. And that financial crisis has nothing to do with Bitcoin. But it just happened at that same time, which is really strange if you think about it. Because now the world, at least a small angry percentage of the world, who just lost their homes, or they just lost their mortgage, or they just lost their pension fund, was angry. Who are they angry at? Banks, insurance companies, central banks. They said, this is unacceptable. We need a better system. And some of them, who were kind of advanced in kind of computer science, found Bitcoin. And they said, holy smokes, who the hell made this? Because usually when you make a powerful technology, you want to be the face. I built this technology. Like, give me a patent. Give me a company. This is my thing. But that's not the case here. There's no company. There's no patent. It's open source. There's no one talking about it. This guy is nowhere to be found. There's no funding. There's no economics. There's no other engineers. What in God's green earth is this? And guess what? Because there was nobody, the community started to gravitate towards it. Developers like you guys started to think it was cool. So you started running Bitcoin nodes on your computer. So you started participating in its consensus algorithm. So you started developing on what was the Bitcoin core, initial version. And between 2008 and 2011, only complete cryptographic junkies, like people that are just super obsessed with cryptography, knew about it. But that community became not bad, not too small, at least 10,000 people probably. Engineers, hackers. And they started thinking, this is a really cool idea, peer-to-peer money, this is the craziest thing I've ever heard in my life. And then in 2011, Bitcoin jumped in price from like almost no value to like $1,000. And that's the first time mainstream attention was applied to it. That's when, like, holy smokes, this thing goes up this fast? You know when something goes up fast, everyone starts to pay attention. That's what I started off with, right? And now different types of people started getting introduced. You got companies and startups, you got investors, you got different, holy smokes, this could be something. This could be like the internet. And between 2011 and 2017, that community started to grow. I'm a part of that community. That's when I got introduced to it. And that's when I think the broad kind of current crypto kind of community was formed. I'm sure that's when you got introduced to it too. When did you buy your first Bitcoin?
Around 5 years back.
Oh my goodness. Did you keep it?
sort of.
Some of it, right? Yeah, you kept it, you told some of it. 5 years back, what did you buy it for? What price?
It was around 23,000.
Rupees.
23,000.
No way. That's 300. Oh my God.
It's like 7 lakhs.
Easily 7 lakhs. Oh man. So then 2017 happened, and then the world found out about it. It became the biggest thing, and then it's either everyone loves it, or everyone hates it, or everyone doesn't know anything about it. And that's kind of the nature of what it is. But in the world of physics, you have these laws of unintended consequences. I intend to do this. I need to charge my laptop, so I unplug the other plug. Guess what? That's the lights. Unintended consequences happen all the time. And Satoshi Nakamoto wanted to fix payments. He wanted to create a consensus algorithm that would allow all of us to act as validator nodes on using some technology that had already been here, SHA-256 encryption, which is like everywhere already. He wanted to reinvent payments. And what he did inadvertently, or maybe directly, we don't know. Maybe one day I'll meet him and I'll ask him. Which is, he reinvented the modern database structure. The big advancement of blockchain is not cryptocurrency. It is not. I mean, I love cryptocurrency, but trust me, I'm even aware that the big advancement is not cryptocurrency. Cryptocurrency is a very small play in the greater blockchain ecosystem. Email is important. We all use email. It's a big app, Gmail or Yahoo, whatever it is. But you would never say that email is the internet. You would say that email is one of the things that the internet can facilitate. But the internet also does so many other things. And that's the comparison between cryptocurrency and the blockchain. The blockchain facilitates, enables the creation, modification, and continuation of cryptocurrency. But there's so much more to it. And why is there so much more? Is because when you build a structure, a network protocol, that's primal objective is immutability. Now you can use that same network protocol for not just currency, but for anything that needs to be immutable. I said, what's the first thing that wants to be made immutable? You said banks. What would be the second thing where you don't want people tampering, or if they tampered, everyone would know? What about medical records? That's pretty important. I heard people here go to the hospital and like get the wrong leg operated on. That happens? Yes, no one, you don't want your medical records, insurance, real estate, deeds, like land ownership, marriage records, death certificates. There are a lot of things that you care about immutability, but there is no system of the world that actually enables it cryptographically in code. They used to say, and on the American dollar, it says, in God we trust. And I think some Bitcoin fanatics said, in code we trust. Because there is a mathematics of cryptography are fundamentally immutable. And that baked into a consensus algorithm that allows dynamic game theory to adjust who participates and fully incentivizes people to participate in support of that network protocol is now captured the brains of developers everywhere. And these developers are people that are just like you, but have now kind of fell into this rabbit hole. That's a word you guys use here, Alice in Wonderland. You fall into the rabbit hole, you can't get out. It's like a well, you can't get out. But mentally, when you go there, now you realize, whoa, I can create my own blockchain. I can create a sub-blockchain. I can create a cryptographically insured way for university registrations. I can create a way to make sure that toll roads are charging automatically. Wait, I can combine artificial intelligence with an immutable ledger. And then the cap blew off. Pandora's box, what's the Indian version of Pandora's box? Pandora's box is something, when you open it up and you let that out, there's no going back. The internet in 1995 was Pandora's box. You open that up, nobody thought you'd be watching cat videos. Nobody thought TikTok would take over the world. Had you asked Mark Andreessen, who invented Netscape, do you think There'd be one day people lip singing in videos, and that would become like consumption of the world. He would say no. But that's Pandora's box. The internet changed everything. The people that learned how to program in web-based languages in 2000 became the prominent engineers of the day. Forget about money. You're going to make more money than you can ever imagine if you learn these skills at such an early time. But the type of work you do is on the bleeding edge of computer science. Not even the edge, bleeding, like blood is still running hot. Because it is shaping, reshaping the way companies, governments, institutions think about their servers, their data storage policies, and how their community, how their customers, how their citizens are going to demand that everything is immutable. Because it can be. That is my forte for today. Would you like to, do you want to preface anything? Do I need to preface anything or you got it? Perfect. Guys, this, all I hope to do with that kind of introduction was, like I said, remember, don't believe anything I said. Go home tonight and Google everything. And I assure you, you will be shocked. It is the most captivating component of computer science. You must know about it. To be a literate engineer doesn't mean you're going to be a blockchain developer. Just like you didn't need to be, you know, some type of developer to understand what's happening in your sequence. But guys, something that affects every, what is the big building across the street? Is Oracle is close to here? What product does Oracle make? Databases, SQL. You type in Oracle blockchain and see how much money they've invested in blockchain. Just type it in. The biggest database provider on planet Earth. Everything, this university, that hospital, that airport, that government, that bank is running SQL. Why are they trying to destroy their own business and go into the blockchain? Because it's an inevitability. Because sometimes companies are pretty stupid, but they get it. When their neck is on the line, they get it. Guys, trust me, you do not want to miss this. Has nothing to do with me. This is so much bigger than me. This is so much bigger than us. All I hope to do is inspire interest. If you are interested, go home and Google it. You can learn everything you want on the internet, trust me. If you want to work in blockchain, then you can come see Mr. Rafael Nadal. No, I'm joking, his name is Rafi. he manages all of the kind of licensing, administrations, placement, stuff like that at Nvest Labs. Ramesh is, again, head blockchain instructor. He's going to walk you through somewhat of a hands-on experiment in the blockchain that I think will be revealing and funny as you guys try to do it. It is super interesting. Guys, remember, the last thing I'll say, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to learn blockchain. Trust me, machine learning is way harder than blockchain. Like multitudes harder, right? Some of my friends run like advanced, I would say like federated, one of my friends runs a federated learning company, which is like how you can render machine learning algorithms in the device instead of sending it to the cloud and back. And this type of stuff he works on is incredible. And even that cannot be done properly without an immutable transactional ledger. So again, the intersection of artificial intelligence and blockchain is going to be one that dominates computer science for the next two decades. You guys are the minds that should be dominating computer science for the next two decades. And we hope that you will endeavor to educate yourself on that concept. And Ramesh will now take what I said theoretically and try to make some hands-on realization out of it. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it greatly.
And he's only 24 years old. So he should be an inspiration to you all, and he's an inspiration to all of us in the company. And trust me, he's a very good speaker, and everyone is inspired by how he comes across and how he puts things across. Thanks again, Sharupan. So today, what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to show you a couple of examples, probably, and we're going to concentrate on the underlying technology, which is the blockchain. I'm going to show how you can install a wallet and why we need a wallet. And I'll give you a basic description of what the blockchain is, get a better understanding of what distributed ledger technology is. And we'll be focusing on Ethereum. Now, most of the developers, the blockchain developers are all Ethereum developers. They're going to be building smart contracts on the Ethereum platform. And Ethereum is not a cryptocurrency. It's a platform where you can build decentralized applications. Those are called DApps or DApps. I guess some of you must be familiar. So before I start, I just want to want to get an understanding of just like if anyone is aware of the blockchain technology itself. I mean, what is the least that you can tell about the blockchain? I guess you must have now. You should have a better idea of what the blockchain is. But if you could give me, if someone is, I'm pretty sure at least one of you should be familiar with the technology. Anyone has heard about Ethereum blockchain? Yeah, you are, right? Aware of, you know what smart contracts are? Anyone is, okay, how familiar are you with JavaScript? I mean, JavaScript, at least you know the basics, right? You know, you can get, what are variables, what are data types, etc. That's all you need. And let me just explain what a blockchain specialist needs, okay? First of all, prerequisites, basically. What are the requirements? One, you need to be familiar with any programming language. It doesn't need to be any, specific to just JavaScript. If you're familiar with Python, you have PyEthereum, or you have other, scripting languages that you can use to create your smart contracts. You have LLL, you have Go, Go Ether. And even Python, there are some contractors, but the current best programming language I would suggest is Solidity. Okay, Solidity is the programming language where you can start building your smart contracts. Okay, so you know what the blockchain is, right? It's based on three main technologies. Okay, you need to know cryptography. You don't actually need to know a lot of cryptography. You need to understand cryptography. It's all about encryption. You know how encryption works, right? And blockchain is nothing but trust. Okay, if you have some $100, you want to give it to your friend. You want to know that he's going to return it back or something. If you go to the bank, the bank almost takes transaction fees and all, right? So we are preventing all that from happening using this blockchain technology. And it can be used in a variety of fields. I'll show you some of those use cases of blockchain. So let me just introduce myself. I'm Ramesh. I've got a total of 9 years work experience. I worked with different companies like Accenture. I worked with Converges. I worked with Unisys. Prior to Nvest Labs, I worked with Unisys. I worked as a lifecycle management team. So my profile was not related to blockchain, but I was investigating what cryptocurrencies are. So initially, I started off trading, but then I realized the underlying technology is a lot more important than the cryptocurrencies itself. So that's when I got into Ethereum. I understood what the technology is all about. I understood what are smart contracts. I learned, it was all self-learned. So, right, like I told you, right, there's a transaction fees. Now, if Chandler wants to send Joey like $100, he only gets $98. The $2 is taken by the bank, right? Now the bank, they take some sort of transaction fees. $2 could be a small amount for one person. And imagine, so just see, JP Morgan Chase, of Bank of America, and Wells Fargo almost earned $6 billion just from ATM and overdraft fees. That's a huge amount, right? And banks are synonyms of crisis. You heard about depression, the Great Depression, where the housing price fell like 31.8%, where unemployment was about 9% in 2010. So blockchain solves a lot of issues for. Because of this, okay, it's immutable. Like Sharupan was saying, it's immutable. But what is immutable? How do you know? I'm going to explain like how it's immutable. I'll show you why they say blockchain is immutable. So anything immutable is nothing but anything written on the blockchain, right? It cannot be erased. It cannot be changed. It cannot be replaced. Once something is written, that's it. Now, you familiar with cryptographic hash SHA-256, or if some of you are aware, basically. SHA-256 is an algorithm. Anything you put into that, any data, any information, like my name or anything, right? You put it into that algorithm, you get a hash of a fixed length. Okay, anything. It could be the whole of Wikipedia, and you'll still get the data of one fixed length. Okay, so let's start with a hash. Imagine this is a hash. Okay, it's an hashing algorithm. We'll take SHA-256. That's used by the Bitcoin blockchain. Now I put in any data. I put in my name. Okay, I put in my name, I get a hash of a fixed length. If you see the last few digits, it's DEA, okay? Now, if I make any sort of changes, now you just put in a full stop, the hash completely changes. Okay, that's how the hashing algorithm works. I put in any sort of information, you get a different hash for anything. So even if I put the whole of the Wikipedia, I'll get a different hash. Now, what is a block? A block is nothing but a list of transactions, okay, a distributed ledger technology is nothing but, imagine a centralized system, what happens? Take a bank. any sort of transaction between you and me, right, it's stored in the central system, it's with a bank, and the bank has access to everything of that, right? It can make any sort of changes, and you know, you don't have control, you can't view the transaction, you can't see anything. But a distributed ledger technology is basically nothing but, imagine that particular ledger, it's not in the central database, it's been distributed. Just imagine the database is actually distributed between nodes. Nodes are systems like you and me who becomes the part of the network, who's interested in becoming the part of the network. And you have some people who are special miners, okay? They are miners. And what their job is to do is to validate the transaction between you and me. Okay, they validate it, they add it to the ledger, and it's distributed. It gets updated in any sort of ledger that is with you. So today what we'll do is, we'll just go ahead and first I'll help you install a wallet where you can try and send some transaction between you all to just check how it works. And I'll also show you like one smart contract. It'll be the hello world of blockchain. So it'll give you an idea of like what, you know, this how smart contracts work and how we can start building decentralized applications on it. So imagine this is one particular block, okay? And this is a hash for my particular block. Now imagine the miners, right? The miners are basically people who will try and validate a transaction that happened between you and me so that it will get broadcasted to the rest of the nodes and it will get updated in their ledger. Now I sort of make some sort of changes here. Any change I make, it becomes an invalid block. Now the miners are trying to find some kind of hash that has four zeros in the front, and they're getting a unique value, which is called as a nonce. Okay, nonce was actually, it was abbreviated as nonsense, but it's actually not nonsense. It has a value, I mean, it has a specific functionality. Basically, you're getting, the miners are trying to do some calculation in the back end, okay? Now, you might be wondering, why are the miners, you know, spending so much time and energy? Because mining is very expensive. I'll show you a mining rig in China. Miners are no one, but they use high-end equipment, okay? Basically hardware graphical cards, right? So I'll show you some of the mining rigs. This is what you need to just start mining bitcoins. If you heard about mining, you see this is like in China. So this much computational power is needed to basically validate a transaction in the blockchain. And it's huge, okay, and the electricity consumption is very huge. It's called proof of work, basically adding a block to the blockchain. All they do is they're trying to validate the transaction, and they need this kind of equipment to basically, solve a mathematical puzzle. It's called proof of work. So imagine they're trying to use that equipment to find a particular value with a hash that has four zeros in the front. Now take a blockchain, it's just a list of blocks, okay, the blocks which has all the transaction values, the transaction that happened between you and me, it's added in one block, and that block, it gets added to the blockchain, and every block that comes after it, right, it'll have the hash of the previous block. Now I told, once you change the hash, it's not possible. They say that Bitcoin is, blockchain is not hackable, right? No bad actor can actually hack the blockchain. It's been 11 years since the blockchain was developed, and no one is able to hack the blockchain itself. You must have heard about stories where the exchanges were being hacked, but not the blockchain itself. Now, for example, I try sort of making some changes in this particular block, okay? It becomes an invalid block, and the hash will completely change. Now, what I need to do is, if I'm a bad actor or a hacker, I'll need to start mining every block to make it a valid block. I'll have to do it. So which is why they say the blockchain is immutable. Basically, you can't make any sort of changes on the blockchain. Okay, now let's go ahead and install the wallet. I need you guys to go to metamask.io. metamask.io. We're basically creating a wallet. A wallet is, think of it as an account, okay? Like you can send and receive transactions. So your bank account number, but you'll have a very unique address where you can send and receive funds. So the MetaMask is an Ethereum wallet where you can store and send and receive money. Now we're not going to be sending real money, so we'll be using something called as the fake Ether. Ether is the cryptocurrency that is specific to Ethereum. So go ahead and install this particular wallet. Just follow the instructions. It's an online wallet, just a Chrome extension. When you click on the Chrome extension, it'll start installing it. Take you to the Chrome Web Store and just click on Add to Chrome. And if you're doing it in this systems, right, you know, make sure you'll be getting a mnemonic phrase. It's actually a 12-digit password something that in case you lose your password, you'll be able to retrieve that particular, you know, wallet using that word, 12-digit word. So go ahead and try installing it, add extension. You can uninstall it later if you're using this, you know, the public systems, because you know, anyone who's got access to your password or the thing, they'll be able to, you know, take your funds from your system. But since you're using fake Ethereum, it doesn't matter, but just to keep you. So as developers, why do you need a wallet? No, blockchain developers, why do you need a wallet? Okay, when you start creating smart contracts, right, when you start creating decentralized applications, you'll need to pay the miners. You're actually connecting your application to the blockchain. Okay, basically, you know, when you create a normal application, what happens? The browser, it gets connected to the server, and then it takes the data from the from the database, and it showcases to the user, right? Similarly, it doesn't get connected to the server. In blockchain apps, it connects directly to the blockchain. So it's just taking some time to install. Just follow the instructions, just click on anything like I agree. Create a password for yourself. You'll be taken to this page, okay? This is where you'll get your mnemonic phrase. It's basically a 12-word phrase. You can click on it. Make sure you copy it somewhere. And I'm displaying mine because I'm not going to be using this wallet, but in case you are planning to store some funds in this particular wallet, it's better not, you know, revealing your mnemonic phrase. After which, you'll be taken to this page where you need to confirm your secret backup phrase, okay? And all you guys need to do is just follow the same pattern. So pigeon, glow, shoe, dom. Okay, just follow the instructions and you'll get to a page where you'll get to confirm your secret backup phrase. Pigeon, glow, shoe, dom, glow, shoe, dom. Decorate, bring, gossip, and ego. Decorate, bring. Advance notice, right? Advance. Okay. Transfer tunnel, right? Tunnel should be front. Okay, tunnel. Advance. So you'll get to this page, okay? I'll show you how you can get some free ether. Free ethers are nothing but a cryptocurrency that you can send and receive. So go ahead and you'll need to change the main Ethereum network. Now the main Ethereum network is where you'll be using real ether, okay? Now one ether will cost you like 15,000. So we can't afford it. So go ahead and just click on Robston test network. You'll get some free ether from the Robston test network. Click on deposit. And yeah, test faucet. So if you are able to get some free ether, right, you just click on, you'll get an option to just get some free ether. Once you do it, try, you know, transferring to each other, you know, copy each other's address. So your address is this one right here is your address. You can click on it a couple of times, you'll get a couple of free ether. And it will take some time to receive your funds. So what is happening that between that time, right, it takes around 12 seconds. Basically nothing but the miners are actually validating the transactions. So the miners are mining and they're confirming the transaction. They're coming to an agreement, okay, this is a valid transaction and it's getting added to the block. So basically all the miners, the nodes, this particular transaction gets added in a block and it gets added in the blockchain. Okay, that's what is happening. Now, if you just refresh your page, you should see some free Ether on your account. It should take around, like, give it like 20 to 30 seconds. And here is where you'll see the block explorer. You'll see something called as a transactions, just below the thing. Okay, now you'll notice that it's pending. And this is my address. No, this is the faucet's address. I requested for one Ether, and this is to my Ether. It's just taking some time for the confirmation. So I've got like one Ether. Just go ahead and transfer it to each other. Yeah. Sorry?
Sir, I had a doubt. You told me, suppose any transaction is happening, mining should happen, then the transaction will happen.
Correct.
The mining will take around 10 minutes or 15 minutes.
No, that is a Bitcoin blockchain. We're using the Ethereum blockchain, which will take like 12 seconds.
Let's take Bitcoin only. So
okay.
Suppose I have a Bitcoin transaction, it will take 10 minutes.
Around 10 minutes.
Suppose I order something also, but
it will take 10 minutes. Yeah, I know what you exactly mean. That's why they have many things in place. They have scalability, okay? That's called scalability because the transaction happens swiftly. So they're implementing many EIPs, improvement protocols. Just to increase the speed, so that's still in the underway. That's why.
Can you say? Here everything depends on miners. So suppose my friend is a miner, mm-hmm. so I can do the broad transitions to another.
No, that's the part. Basically, it's called 51%. 51%. If you have, you need to control 51% of the nodes to be able to make some sort of changes in the blockchain. Okay, and if you try to make,
I'm a fraud and I have a 51% population and I am making a fraud.
That is possible. It is possible. But controlling the 51% of the nodes, you need like $70 billion or something, which is no point, right? You can either use that money to mine blockchain. So you're controlling the whole node. It's just like almost impossible to control the nodes. Okay, so I hope you guys were able to send some transactions to each other. Now, people say blockchain is immutable, right? It's false. Blockchain is mutable. I mean, you can hack the blockchain, but you need to control 51% of the nodes. So 51% of the nodes, if you're able to control, right, you can hack the blockchain. But the reason it's impossible or it's not feasible, right? You'll need like $7 billion or $8 billion to basically control 51% of the nodes, which is pointless. You can spend that amount in mining and you can make double the amount. So that's why people haven't tried controlling the 51% of the nodes. Okay, now I'll show, if you're able to do the transactions, well and good. Now I'll show you a smart contract which you guys can start following. And there is a browser called Remix. It's an online IDE. Okay. An online IDE Remix, where you can write, compile, and deploy your contract, and we can also try testing it. So I'll show you the hello world of Ethereum blockchain. Please go to this website. Go to Remix IDE. I guess someone is already familiar with smart contracts, right? I mean, you're already working on smart contracts, or you're learning, or what is it? Last semester, you had a blockchain class, is it? Okay, interesting. Good. So let's create our first smart contract. This is the hello world of smart contract. Okay, you can just create. You type in something called as Pragma Solidity 0.5.1. Remix.ethereum.org. And if you really want to become like blockchain developers, right, once you start becoming high-tech developers, you'll be working on the Truffle framework. The Truffle framework is nothing but the application, it's a framework where you can start creating a decentralized application. Okay, first of all, click on the plus point on the left-hand side to create a new smart contract. Okay, name it like Greeter. .sol. SOL stands for Solidity, it's the extension. And type in Pragma Solidity. This particular lines basically tells the remix tool that we're using a specific version of Solidity, which is 0.5.1. And Solidity is a statically typed language where you need to specify the data type. So you need to specify string greeting, or if it's a UINT. If it's a number, it'll be a UINT or UINT 256. So this is Truffle, where you'll be, if you're planning to become a blockchain developer, you'll be working on these applications. Truffle is a environment where you can start building your contracts. It'll help you compile and write your codes and even deploy your codes and even test your whole smart contract. You have something called as a Ganache. Ganache is like something like a local blockchain that you can install on your system itself. It'll be as if you're connecting to the blockchain with some fake ether. Then you have something called as a Drizzle, which is just for the front end, creating the front end libraries. So go ahead. Yeah, click on deposit. Then click on go down. Okay, this is like, close this. You need to change the Ethereum network. Okay, first of all, the first line, right? Guys, yeah. So the first line is basically, it's going to specify the version of Solidity code that you're going to write it in. So for here, we're writing Solidity and 0.4.1. For instance, if you're using PyEther or if you're using the LLL language, you'll just need to specify the language that you're going to be using. And this is basically defining a new contract. It's similar to class in JavaScript, Java. And so the fourth line declares the instant variable. Just imagine this particular thing, right? This instant variable. Okay, this is called an instant variable, okay? And anything you pass on to this particular function, it's going to be stored on the blockchain. So any value you add it to the greeting state variable, it'll get added on the blockchain itself. Okay, it's directly getting stored on the blockchain. So it's a very simple greeter hello world kind of smart contract where you're actually, when you call the function, you will get the hello world and you can replace it with any greeting you want. And we're saying it as public so that you'll be able to view it outside the smart contract. Of course, you won't get all of this at one day itself, but if you've done it, let's try compiling it. On the left-hand side, you'll see another. You'll see that Solidity compiler on the left-hand side. Click on compile, and it should automatically compile your contract. And you have something called as a deploy and run transaction on the left-hand side. Click on deploy, and you'll get an instance of the smart contract at the bottom of the screen. So here I'll be able to view I can call the function. I can just click on greet, and I should get hello world here. And when I can change my greeting to something else, like hi there. So when I set the greeting, I should get hi there initially. And you'll notice something happening on the bottom here. You're able to compile it and deploy.
Not linear.
Okay, click on this plugin tab and search for compile. Activate. And click on here and search for deploy. And click on this here. Search for compile and deploy. Compile. Activate this and just compile and then click deploy and activate it. Okay, some of you guys may not have this particular plugin. Okay, just go to this plugin at the bottom of the screen and enable it. You basically need to enable it. Okay, you can search for deploy or compile. You just need these two plugins for now. It's compile and deploy. You can search for the plugin and then activate it. So you created the greeter order. So right now, activate the plugin like compiler. Compile, activated. Search for deploy. Yeah, we have a training thing going on here. We have something called as Ethereum developer level, certified Ethereum developer level 1 and level 2. Hope you guys were able to call and deploy and compile the contract. On the top, on the if you go to this particular tab, right, Solidity compiler, you'll see something like the compiler. It is basically the version of Solidity. And second, you'll have the language. You can choose a language like UUL as well. And Ethereum versions are nothing but, you know, the versions of Ethereum. So blockchain itself. Initially it was Homestead, then it moved to Spurious Dragon, then we had Byzantium. These are just like EVM versions, Ethereum Virtual Machine. And also once you go to the next tab where you'll deploy and compile, if you note here we have something called as JavaScript VM. The environment is JavaScript VM. Imagine this is just like a fake Ethereum blockchain, okay, which has a few Ether in it. It's got like a few accounts with fake Ether. Like here I have like 99 Ether, 100 Ether, anything. And if you want to choose this MetaMask that you installed, right, click on the next tab, Injected Web3, which will have you connect to the MetaMask wallet. And if you connect it, you can still deploy it using. And now you're connected to the MetaMask fake Ethereum blockchain. And you'll be able to deploy and call that function. So if, for example, if I try, I get this pop-up, just click on confirm. And note, if you notice, you see something called as a gas fee. Gas fee is just basically the transaction price that you're paying the miners. Okay, it'll be like some 3 rupees or 2 rupees. Basically, you're paying the miners for helping you with this particular transactions. So if I, anytime I call, whenever I call the function, I'll be asked to pay something. And this is just the block explorer, which will give you, which is basically what is happening in the blockchain itself. You'll see the transaction hash, you'll see the block number, you'll see what is called as the timestamp, the time the transaction happened. Okay, so were you guys able to deploy and run the contract? Were you able to? Awesome. So you created your first smart contract, tap yourself on the back. Of course, you didn't understand many, a lot of it. But then, I mean, as you start learning Solidity, right, it gets easier. So, and the blockchain, you know, multiple, many companies are hiring right now. They're looking for blockchain specialists. If you look at LinkedIn, it's the top skill and, you know, it's the top skill. You know, for another year or so, I mean, like for 2020, that's the topmost skill and requirement for most of the companies that they're hiring. And they're working on proof of concept at the moment. So many companies are actually looking at blockchain technology and checking like how it can be used in different aspects or how they can implement blockchain in their workspace itself. And what else? So blockchain can be implemented with multiple other technologies like IoT, AI, machine learning, right? They can take advantage of any company that requires trust. Now, first of all, you should remember one thing, like blockchain is not for every company. If they already have a database or something, it's not required. I mean, if they want something related to trust, if they want some kind of, you know, a transaction that needs to be happened securely, that's where you'll need, you can have, take advantage of the blockchain. Yeah. So, Don, do we have any questions?